Well, good morning, everybody. It is October already. Oh, my goodness. October the 3rd. And boy, this year has just gone by like a rocket, as it usually does. It's a matter of fact, the older you get, the faster it goes. That's just the way it is. So we got to get used to that. Anyway, lots going on today. Lots going on. Tonight we have our kickoff call for the month of October. We have a new month. We got a new quarter, or we're in the midst of the last quarter, October, November, December of the year. Now, as I've been reviewing my book and rewriting, I'm confronted with looking at what I said maybe a month ago, a year ago, what's happened in between, and how does this make sense with what we're all involved with. And I guess about maybe 3 weeks ago, I decided to go on a different route of information. As you all know, I never sold retail products. And the main reason why I didn't sell retail products, as a matter of fact, I'm going to mute a couple of people just to thank you. Because in my time, we were all about the opportunity. Now, in the sense of the opportunity, what we were really doing was we were communicating to other people with that direction. So pretty simple. So in other words, it would be like promoting to renters versus promoting to house buyers. So I was promoting to the house buyer, whereas the another choice could have been to go after the house renter. Two different people, two different sets of circumstances. And so therefore there was a choice. Now, because the opportunity fit, and what I mean by fit, if we looked at what was going on in society, we were just coming out of a recession. There was loads of money to be, you know, that people could go after. There was no internet. And so people were looking for solutions or ways to help them as individuals survive and do better and, you know, what we all did. So in my particular case, as you know, from the stories that have been told and the videos that you've listened to, my budget was $8,000 a month at that time. So for me, what I was looking at when I was approached about this was how do I get those two things to meet? And I had tons of experience with network marketing, you know, 13 different companies over a period of about 15 years, and not all of it was positive. Most of it actually was quite negative. And my opinions, my considerations were very negative about this particular style of doing business. But what I saw was then, you know, it's the beauty's in the eye of the beholder. So what finally I got to see was some big money. And that was the big money that attracted my attention. Well, 3 weeks ago, I decided that, you know, there's some people, there's other ways that things can be done. There's another group of people that we could go after. And so I've been interviewing retailers and finding out what they do. Now, this is really fascinating. A lot of times what happens on the Zoom calls that you go on, and I try and go on all the Zoom calls so I hear what other people are doing, you hear results. But you don't get the what do they do stuff. You know, it's like, they go, well, I've got 45 million, you know, subscriptions. Or I, you know, got to silver, I got to gold. Okay, those are all good. I mean, that's what we're trying to get to. But what was really important to my understanding is, as I was doing this business growing up, was, okay, well, it's great that you made $22,000 in your first month. Well, what'd you do? And so I could look at what they did and then look at what I needed to do and what I needed to understand how to do. I mean, it's just, that was what I was taught and how I looked at things. So, you know, the first approach was, we got to put together a list of 200 people. Well, my first barrier there was I didn't have 200 people to put on a list. So it's almost like, oh, how could I do this? But then I understood that what they were really saying is, okay, you got to talk to people. And this is a great way for you to get started. So make a list and then, you know, get with your sponsor, figure out your top 20, top 10, and then figure out a strategy of how you go talk to them. Well, I bypassed those two steps because I'd played this game before. So I knew that, okay, we got this new deal. It's called Neekin. Main product is sleep system magnets, new. People don't know about it. Create a story, go out there and see, you know, well, how's things going? What you doing? What are you up to? Would you be interested in taking a look at something? You know, that usual how you open the door in fanfare. Well, what was fascinating back then is we didn't have any way of checking us out. The only way you could check us out is, you know, maybe go to Encyclopedia Britannica, maybe call somebody on Wall Street. You know, how could you check it out other than going to a meeting and listening to what somebody said or listening to, well, I tried this product and it fixed my lymphosis. Whoa, great. So I'm going to try it too. I mean, it was word of mouth. And in the sense of word of mouth, that worked to attract attention. In the reality of building the business, that was the check that became the instrument of, you know, this is what I'm making by doing this activity. And if you want to make this kind of money, blah, blah, blah. And that's what we did. Well, somebody said something to me the other day and I thought, well, let's take a look at this because I haven't done this. And so I started to interview various and sundry people. And it was Ruth Lowe, actually, that was on a call that Ben Woodward did. And it was Ben Woodward did this call about subscriptions. And this all started because of, and then last week, Luis talked about leverage. And how, you know, leveraging time and leveraging subscription, you know, I mean, all of this stuff around the idea of leverage. And I don't want to segue too far away, but to just make sure you look up the word leverage to understand what that means as far as a tool and a resource, because really I'll get into it in another time because it's very interesting. But anyway, so Ruth got on with Ben and she was talking about how, you know, she had developed this program and she had all these auto ships and that's what his focus was. And those were his questions were being directed in. And she won her trips and the whole game that she's playing is to get enough subscriptions that qualify her for the trip every year. And from the standpoint of that, I started to, well, how do you do that? What is it that you're doing that, you know, that gets you to do that? How did you put all this together? So I called her up and I said, Ruth, you know, I'm really curious about this. And I'm curious for a couple of reasons. In reviewing my information, this is kind of funny, but in reviewing what I wrote and what I've said over the years, sometimes I didn't go back and review what I said. I would say it, I would make sure it was clean to put out then I posted on the website and that was the end of it. Because I knew it, and had applied it and used it, to me, it wasn't a new idea or a revelation about doing anything. It was just normal course of business. And in going back over it and reviewing it for the rewrite and tweaking the book, I had more thoughts on what was said about doing certain things. And one of them was in participating in this business. And what's fascinating about see, what we really have to understand about what Neekin is a platform for you. And what I mean by it's a platform for you, it's, okay, what does Neekin do? Well, they provide us with products. They have a warehouse. They have a customer service department for you. They have technical research with somebody like Dave Balzer. They ship the product. They maintain an administrative system to make sure you get paid. They put on material on the website. You have a back office. You have a website. You have marketing materials. You have slicks for doing ads. You can get, you know, all kinds of other things associated with that. They put on meetings. They put on events. And all of these things are things that you get to use. I mean, when you think about this, it's not, this is your deal. This is your business. And so what you have to do is you have to look at you and say, okay, of all of these things that I'm going to do, how do I utilize this for me? How do I make this work for what I want to do? And so I called up Ruth and I said to Ruth, I said, well, what do you do? And she said, well, this is what I do. I said, I went and joined about 10 or 15 groups on Facebook. Now, these were groups that were really groups that I was interested in. They had something to do with family because I was a mother. And they had something to do with just the social stuff of life and living. And I would monitor the communication that went on these groups. And when I saw something that was of interest, like where they had a comment about health or kids, I would post a comment about that to that person. This is a general depth. Apparently, she has a video on this that I'm going to get a hold of, and we'll do a deeper dive into this. But in the sense of, so what she did was she utilized the platform to then seek out conversations that then she could interject into and then start a private conversation with that person about that topic. Now, when I was reviewing the book and looking at, well, how does this business work? Well, it works on communication. It's all about communicating. It's you communicating with somebody else. It's you getting into a conversation about what you have. It's you finding out what's important to them. It's you finding out what's needed and or wanted. And then you match what matches. And it all works when you create agreement on how it works. Or you create agreement on a system, or you get agreement on a route to take, or, you know, it's like you, let's say you like going out into nature and walking, and you're with somebody that doesn't like to walk, but they want to ride a bike. And there's just the two of you. Okay, well, I want to walk, I want to ride the bike. I want to walk, I want to ride the bike. So you don't have an agreement on, you know, but we want to take this trail. Oh, okay. Well, why don't I ride the bike, you walk, and then we'll keep meeting up every, you know, mile or 2 miles or three. Okay, that might work. You form some kind of agreement to make it work. If you can't form an agreement, it doesn't work. It would be the same thing as going out, you know, with, you say you're a couple and you're going out for dinner. Where do you want to go to eat? Well, I want to go to the Habit Burger place. No, I don't want to eat that. It's too much fat. I can't do that anymore. I got to go to, you know, something that's got vegetables and so on and so forth. So back and forth, you communicate back and forth until you finally come up. Okay, let's go there. Okay, they got both for us. You form the agreement. So what I observed growing up in this business was those that got involved and did something agreed with it. Agreed with it, agreed with the business, agreed with the technology, agreed with the product, agreed with the need, agreed with the style, agreed with what they need. Everything was based on some form of an agreement. And you've heard me say a gazillion times that the reality that comes about is based on agreement. So the reality of us being on this call today, and for those of you that are watching the recording, was based on an agreement to do so. If you didn't agree to do this, then you wouldn't be here. And so in looking back, you know, at my track record of what went on, or looking at the track record of Nikan of what went on, everything happened because of these agreements that kept occurring. Where there was an agreement, it didn't work. So here she gets on the internet, back to Ruth. She hears something that's important to her. She chimes in a conversation. Conversation starts. Step one, conversation starts. Now, that's just the beginning. In an analogy from another form, it's when I was selling oil and gas investments. The first thing is I had to establish a communication line with somebody. I had to reach out. And so they gave us these cards with a name and a number and a position and a company. And dial the phone. Hello, Mr. Jones. Yes. Okay. If I got a hold of Mr. Jones, I'm establishing some form of communication. Now, the next step was to find something to agree upon. Otherwise, it isn't going to work. You have to form agreements because you got, again, let's look at it in the sense of what she did. So what she then did was she would hear or observe a communication about maybe taking care of a kid, maybe taking care of a family member, dealing with an owie, whatever, because she's product focused, and that was her objective. And then she'd jump in and make a comment about that and start to establish a communication to the point where it would go off the main and into a private chat. I don't know how to do this yet, but that's what apparently happens. You go to into a private chat and you start talking with the person that you want to talk to. Well, the same thing happened when I was doing oil and gas. I'd contacted people. I'd ask them a couple of questions. We'd talk about something. And what we talked about was investing. And was investing, you know, something that he did. And if he said no, no agreement, move on. If he said yes, we have agreement, move on. You follow where I'm coming from here. So it's like he agreed to he wanted more information. She's on with somebody that wants to communicate more information, and then away you go. These conversations, once they went private, would maybe go an hour and a half. She'd do anywhere from 5 to 8 a week. And as a result of that, she gained 5 to 7 customers every month. Those 5 to 7 customers over the course of the year got her to Team Tai Chi and gave her a very nice income to boot. Now, the income that she makes goes along with the income her husband makes, and they've improved their lifestyle. And what I was thinking about was, now we're talking about 40 grand a year with both the trip and that, you know, and the commissions that go along with it. But here's what's really interesting and fascinating about this is the residual of creating the subscriptions, you know, the, you know, supplying all the filters. And but more importantly, she's now got, and this really struck me, it's the same thing I did, it's just a different method, it's a different game, it's a different strategy. So I built up a distribution network of distributors. I leveraged my energy with their energy. That created the ongoing residual income that lasted for years and years and years, still going on. And so that's what she's done in this particular process. She's created this customer base of loyal customers and consumers that are buying her product. And she's having, you know, she's doing this on a part-time basis, which is really kind of fascinating. So I thought to myself, okay, so one of the most interesting things about this, Nikan, or anything, is basically what this represents in terms of potential opportunity for the amount of effort and work that you have to put into it. Now, I've worked jobs, not very many in my life, where I got paid to work in the job. Most of them were as a kid going to school, where I got 25 or 50 cents or 75 cents an hour for doing some laborious job while I went to school. I was a dishwasher in a pizza place. So, you know, I was a truck driver for Canada Dry. You know, I did those things. I was a construction worker. And in that sense, I learned carpentry and things of that nature, which became a great hobby. But when it came time to looking at this model, what was fascinating about it was how it worked and how you could make it work and what it would create for you in the long term. And a couple things that triggered this conversation today. One was our CEO's presentation on leverage, and the other was the presentation on doing the retail and having, you know, a different solution to what your situation or challenges may be. But and then reviewing my information that I wanted to for the rewrite for the book and putting it all together so that you can communicate. Because here's why. We have a very interesting set of circumstances going on in society right now. And what I mean by that is the newest generation, the millennials, the Gen X's, taking over for the baby boomers, there's a tremendous amount of wealth transfer. It's the largest in history that's going on right now because the boomers were very successful and they're passing that wealth on to their children, and they're in a very unique situation. You've got technology moving at a million miles an hour and solving people's problems or trying to solve people's problems and trying to make life easier. And then, you know, I can't get my damn printer to work. The technology sometimes is good, and then sometimes it just drives you nuts. You know, my wife was on with the technical support because her phone that she has to have for the office doesn't take her emails, and she can't get her emails. And so we have a whole different set of problems that people are confronted with and need to deal with on a day-to-day basis. But here's the but. Survival is still survival. And by that, I mean is that people still need to work. People still need to do something. People need to put food on the table, rent, pay the rent, clothes, et cetera, et cetera. If they want to travel, that costs money. If they want nice things, that costs money. And that hasn't stopped. And the reason why I say that hasn't stopped is because we've got this thing called inflation. And inflation is what the government's trying to do is stop you from spending so that they can slow down this machine, because everybody's out there having a good time buying and spending and doing and enjoying. And so what does that tell you? Well, it tells you that they've got something that's giving them that ability, or they need something that gives that ability. Now, I've done all kinds of research, all kinds of Google searches, all kinds of And again, the answer is still the same. People are looking for solutions, but the key is for you to be able to communicate that solution based on who they are. Now, when I took a look at what Ruth did, and I realized that in my education process and what I'm doing in training, I missed the boat here. I missed the boat on a way that could be done that could then equate to the same thing. Because again, what do we do as individuals with this business? We provide people with ways to do the business. So in other words, you take a look at a situation. Now, when I basically got six people that I brought into this business in my career. I brought in more, but six actually that turned out to be the true color of building this business. In other words, George, my first guy, he needed to make money. Plain and simple. That was it. Bottom line, he knew the industry. He knew the concept. He was building a team. He wanted to make money. He did. Second guy, Howard, same thing. He was a broker. He was a sales guy. That's what he lived for. In other words, he made his living by communicating. So when he saw that this was about communicating, but with the added notch of leverage and exponential growth, the light bulbs went off. It was like the guy that first got me, and he said, Dave, imagine if, you know, you owned a Coca-Cola machine on every corner of every street, and somebody, every time somebody bought a Coke, you made a nickel. And I still have the piles of nickels every time I talk about this. So what it did for me is it got my imagination working. It got my creative juices. You know, how do I make this work? How do I do this? How do I inspire others? How do I teach? What do I do? And it took me 15 years to figure it out. And in those 15 years, I had some ups and some downs, but not really much success. I had little bits, little spurts here and there, but nothing consistent until I finally got into Nikon, and it took off there. But it was the education and the learning and the understanding that got me to where I then became successful. And it was understanding this. Your job is to find out what other people need, what other people want, and then to show them how to get that by doing this. It's not about you. Now, this is a fascinating subject. Tonight, I'm doing the kickoff call with Ruben. He asked me to do a segment on it. And the segment was, why is it important to go to big events? And I'm going to give you the spiel, because this is so important as a concept and an understanding about building this business and becoming successful. Everything's important to you. It all matters. It's all part of it. So in other words, if you look at the bigger picture, let's say that there was no Dave Rolfe, there was no Mike DiMuccio, there was nobody that was successful in this business, and the company didn't have very many products, and it didn't have events, and it didn't do anything, and it didn't have a back office, and it didn't have a web page. How exciting could this be? Blah. So it's not about you. It's about understanding what it is for everybody else. So in other words, one of the values of the big events is its perception. I wrote it in my book. It's like if you worked in a company and the president of the company was coming to a meeting and you said, well, I'm not going to go to that meeting. Do you have a choice? Well, when you work for somebody else, no, you're going to that meeting. And there may be donuts, there may not be donuts, but the bottom line is you're going to that meeting. And in our business, we have freedom of choice. But we have to understand that freedom of choice does not mean neglect. What freedom of choice is that you can choose what to do, where to go, how to do it, those kind of things, how you live your life, what direction you're going to take. But one of the things that I learned in building this business was there are rules. And in order to win, you've got to play by the rules. And if you don't play by the rules, then you're going to have a hard time. And it's not about you. It's about what it means to everybody else. So your involvement with the activity is not about you being involved in the activity. It's about other people perceive. So if we go to an event and there's 500 people on that event, what do we think? It's big. It's exciting. You go to the event and there's only 40 people on the event and say, wow, not many people are participating in this. So then the next time you register, well, why don't you think I'll go on that? There won't be any people. See, it's a herd mentality concept. And so I left the business for 3.5 years, and from 1990, fall of 91 or end of 90, 91, 92, and came back in 1994. When I came back, the reason why I came back, company sent a lead and found out there's nobody doing business in Southern California, period. And I had different aspirations and thought, well, maybe I could do something. And so I decided to do what I did before. I held a meeting, rent a hotel, had a meeting, three people showed up. Now I could have said that, and the guy that was in the audience said, Dave, this thing's changed in the last 3 years. I think you better get, you know, do some study about this. And I said, oh, okay, fine. So then I did it. I called my upline. I said, okay, I'm building the business. I want to have a meeting. I want you to come down and help me with the meeting. He said, okay, fine. And so he came down to the meeting. We had seven people showed up. Now, I could have looked at that and said, okay, not very many people want to play here. So I just kept having the meetings. Every Wednesday night, Woodland Hills, Marriott, every night for years. And before the end of it, by the time we got cooking, we had 200 to 300 people coming every night. That started with the 3 and the 7. So what was the moral of that story? Well, the moral of that story is agreement. You see, if the more we all agree that something's going to be, the more it goes, the better it is. Again, I would go to Team Diamond events where there'd be thousands of people there. I'd bring my team, my leaders, my prospects, everybody that I could possibly get. And they got to see the show of shows. Was that encouraging? Absolutely was encouraging. So in doing this business, there are many routes that you can take. The key for each one of you is to figure out what route best suits who you are. But remember this, you want to know what all the routes are, because the way this works is when you show somebody else a potential solution that they can gravitate to and run with. For you, you've got to know what you need to get what you want, and that's what you're ultimately looking for. And the way it works is when you help others get what they want, you get what you want. So I hope this message has some meaning to what you need to do today. And the interesting thing about the retail side is, we'll do some future events on this, this could be a great way to do a lot of different things without being forceful, without being, you know, stomped on. You know, it's a very, very social chit chat stuff, and it opens up the door. So it might be worthy to explore that. All right. So don't forget, tonight we have the kickoff call. I'm going to end this recording and then we'll jump on to our usual Q&A. So hang on. Thanks for being on today. We will see you on the next Smart Networker. Bye for now.